heart to rescue the perishing and to care for the dying. Then the words there, plead with them earnestly, plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Boy, I tell you what, that has just been speaking to my heart. Amen. And I tell you what, I want to plead with them earnestly, but I want to plead with them gently. Amen. To let them know that there is a Savior that cares and He understands. Amen. We have a job to do. Rescue the perishing. Care for the dying. Amen. Lord, help us to be faithful in that area to rescue the perishing. It's up to you and I. Me. I have a job to do. You have a job to do. Somebody said, if you're a born-again Christian, you're a missionary. Amen. You have a job to do. You have a story to tell. And it's the blessed story of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise His holy name. Well, we're happy to have Genevieve Mason here on the platform with us. And they're working with our newest church out in Springfield, Nebraska. And I've asked her to come and at least share with you some of their desire and what they're wanting. They're in need of a pastor. They're in need of a building. Amen. The Lord willing, if Jesus tarries, we're supposed to go out and be with them for 4 or 5 days, I guess, in September. And we're hoping to not only have a short meeting with them, but also maybe to help them in finding something or looking for something and trusting that God will help. Amen. And so she's going to come and share the burden of their heart. Amen. For our new work, Pilgrim Holiness Church out in Springfield, Nebraska. The Lord bless her. She comes at this time. Amen.
Now, my voice is not real strong, so I'll try and get down there where you can hear me.
Good afternoon. As my husband said, it was indeed a privilege to have gone down the end of February, 1st of March, to the island of Dominica. What a trip. What a trip. I'll never, never forget it. And before I forget it, those of you who can and would be interested, come over to the display, Beecher's display, and you can see some of the pictures on our computer that we took while we were down there of the leadership conference. I would encourage you to look at those. So you can see, this is what we were doing. This is what your mission dollars went toward to send us down to the leadership conference. And this is what your nationals, our national pastors are like. This is what the mission compound looks like. This is what the island looks like. Beautiful, gorgeous, like my husband said. I wouldn't even think twice. If God would say, Rustin Isabel, I want you in Dominica. If he'd say, I want you somewhere around the world, I wouldn't think twice. Anywhere he wanted me to go. But Dominica is beautiful, beautiful, gorgeous island, tropical paradise. One thing I didn't like about it, and that's the cockroaches. Oh, my, oh, my, oh, my. Oh, my. But I think if I lived there, I would know how to deal with them. I dealt with them in Honduras. But, boy, they have a good crop of them there in Dominica. Healthy crop. Too healthy of a crop. I guess that's one of the things that go along with the tropical rainforest climate that is there. The mission compound in Glogomier is in a rainforest, and beautiful, just lush green, like you're living in a greenhouse all year long. Beautiful, gorgeous flowers. You'd pay high, big money in the States to get a few of the flowers that just grow wild in Dominica. Gorgeous, beautiful flowers. Everywhere. Delicious food. Oh, we enjoyed the food there. Kind of tickled me. Brother Gray, I think he ate more national food, more native food when we were down there on this trip than he said he ever has. And he really enjoyed it. I think he enjoyed it. Paul enjoyed more than he did of it, but and wait, Russ and I certainly did enjoy it, and it was a pleasure to be able to cook some of it and have some of them come into the kitchen and say, this is how it's done in Dominica. It was a real privilege. We had a great time. It was also a privilege to meet the nationals, put faces to the names that we had heard. We'd heard about pilgrim missions for lots and lots of years when we'd come back on furlough, and we'd hear about pilgrim missions. But it was really, really a privilege to be able to go down to see firsthand, meet the nationals, see the results of years of hard labor that our pilgrim missionaries have put into the field and the results of those labors, and meet the precious brethren. They enjoy serving God. And my, you all, we in here in the States don't know how to sing. If you could just transport yourself to Dominica, they know how to sing. I wish I could bring some of it back. Oh my. They have healthy lungs, healthy vocal cords, just an inbred natural music in them, and it comes out in the worship services, and we really enjoy doing that. Another thing I wish you could have seen were the faces of the pastors' wives and Sunday school teachers, even the pastors themselves, as they opened up the boxes of Betty Lukin's material that you all sent down there. Boy, were they ever excited. And then as I had the privilege Saturday afternoon to give them some orientation on how to use them, how to put it all together, and how to organize it and so forth, oh, they were so excited. And Brother Raines, Don Raines, informs me that he's gone back and give them even a little bit more instruction, and they're using it and having a great time. They're very, very appreciative of it. One thing that really stood out to me as we learned a lot about the work there, the pilgrim mission work in Dominica, we saw that the work in Dominica is at a crossroads. As our resident missionary, since its inception, the work has had a missionary on the island, and then our church decided, and thank the Lord they did, to go over to the island, the neighboring island of Antigua, and start a work. Thank the Lord they decided to do that. We're 100% behind that decision. But like my husband said, we can't do that to the detriment of the work in Dominica. Right. Not to mention the fact, and I'm sure this has been, you know all of this from letters that Brother Beecher has been so faithful to write to you all and Brother Raines, but it's just on my heart. And if it's on my heart, I got to get it off. Also, they had a change in national chairman, all within a year. This is a lot of change, a big change. They're used to having a missionary. They're used to having that leadership there and a national chairman that has been the national chairman for years and years. And then all within a short time span have two major changes. And then the work is like they're on their own. They're standing all by themselves now and a brand new leader. That's tough. That's tough. We're not talking about U.S. oriented, having years of a history of Christianity. We're not talking about that. We're talking about a culture that doesn't have a long history of a Christian church on the island, okay? We're talking about a mission work. God has done a wonderful work in their hearts in Dominica. There's a lot of growing that can be done. The work is at a crossroads, and we feel very, very strongly, and we saw so clearly that one of the secrets is helping our missionary to go back periodically, to keep them encouraged, to help give them a little bit of supervision. They're not to be there on a daily basis necessarily, but right now, until we can come up with another resident missionary that could help in a formal training program that is so vital to the work. If you're going to get a work truly indigenous, you have to train the pastors. You have to train the pastors and the young people and the laymen. They have to be trained. It is a must to have a truly indigenous church that is going to have a solid future. That is a must. It's not an option. And we see if we're not going to let our pilgrim missions money just go down the drain and the church just dwindle because of a lack of vision, we must invest to get a formal training program set up for our pilgrim missions in Dominica. I'm sorry if I'm out of order, but I feel very strong, and those people are so precious. But I see them as wanting to serve God with all of their heart, but yet they don't exactly know how. The pastors are lacking training in techniques and in some basic theology. And how do you go out? How do you evangelize? How do you dig out a new work out of nothing? We have all the material. We just need someone to go down and organize that formal training program. Maybe God wants you. Maybe God wants you to go. Maybe you're in the change of a pastorate and you don't know exactly where to go. Would you pray? Would you seriously pray to see if it's God's will for you to go down to Dominica? As my husband said, it's a beautiful island. There's a mission house there sitting empty. Except when the missionary would come over for a conference or a leadership convention or something like that. Sitting empty, waiting for you, one of you, a couple here, to go to set up a training program for our work in Dominica. We can't let the mission work go downhill and just gradually get smaller and smaller. We can't let that happen. We're pilgrims. Pilgrims know how to put a missions program together. I hear stories about the old missions. Our pilgrim church is an old church, okay? We heard a good, wonderful history the other night about it. They had a thriving, a huge missions program. My in-laws were a part of that program. I've heard about it for years. We are still the Pilgrim Church. We can still have a big, large, thriving missions program. If we're going to continue to grow, if our conference here in the United States is going to continue to grow, we must invest more in our missions program. As my husband said, a growing, thriving church is a missions-oriented church. That is God's word. That is the reason that we are here. That's the reason that God put the church on this earth. Not to get together to have a nice social club and have a good time and listen to a preacher and, oh, it sounded good. Maybe you get a soul saved here or there. No. No, we're supposed to reach out here at home and abroad, around the world. That is God's mandate. That is one of the few prayer requests that Jesus left with us. And if the Pilgrim Holiness Church, which I am very much a part of, if we are going to continue and to grow, we must have a thriving, growing Pilgrim Missions program. It breaks my heart, folks, to hear of the requests that come in to our Pilgrim Missions board. Come to Africa, come to Peru, come to help us with this Indian work. And can we do it? No, we can't even cover what we have. We could. Oh, we could do that plus much more. But do we? No, because we're holding on too tight to the things that God has given us. When you stand before God, are you going to feel real good about having that big, nice, fancy car, that big, nice, fancy home, all the pretty clothes? Is that going to make you feel real good? Or is it going to make you feel better if you have given, if you have truly sacrificed, done without that nice new car? Get along with the same one that you've had for the last 5 years. Get along. Go get it fixed instead of trading it in on a new one and get another payment book. Send that money instead of on a new payment book for a car. Send it to the mission field. I'm sorry. I got this song. But I got to get it off, folks. We as a Pilgrim Church can do so much more for missions than we're doing. God help us. God help us. Time is short, folks. Time is short. Jesus could come any time. And what have we done? What has your church done to reach the world? What has your church done? God help us. God help us. Another thing that breaks my heart, and Lord help me, is to see promises that our conference has made to missionaries. And then because of a lack of finances, because we as the individual Pilgrim churches have not sent in enough money to our mission treasurer to pay those missionaries money that we have promised to give them. We say, yeah, we'll stand behind you. We'll give you such and such amount a month. And then their support list comes in and it's not there. Why isn't it there? Because we didn't give enough. Why is it that the report that was given in conference, $3,000 in the hole? That shouldn't be, folks. That shouldn't be. Lord, help us. Help us. We could do so much more for missions than we're doing. That is the secret of a growing, thriving church, is how we reach out in missions, home missions, foreign missions. We've got to put more emphasis on missions. We've got to put more emphasis. You say, well, I'm afraid if I increase my missions budget, then I'm not going to have enough for our local needs. Oh, fooey on you. You will too. God will supply your needs if you would just step out in faith and say, yes, I'm going to give X number of dollars. I'm going to double what I've given for missions. You just try. I challenge you to try it. God will not fail. We personally, I don't talk much about this. We personally, I mean, sometimes we don't have it there. But we have found out, Rusty and I, we've been missionaries, you know, most of our married life. We weren't in the States very long before we headed to the field. But yet we would support another missionary. We thought, man, we're making missionary salary ourselves. And then for a year or two, we thought, well, we really can't afford this. And we thought, no, things aren't going too well. We need to find a missionary we need to start giving to helping them out. And so we just made that a practice. You just make it a practice, and God will bless you. God will help you. God will supply your needs. He's never failed in the past. You think he's going to start now? No. I encourage you. Just double your, just increase. Just step out on faith today. If they've done it in the past, they're going to be raising some pledges. What are you going to give? What's your church going to give? And so forth. I challenge you just to take a big leap of faith. And let's show the world what Pilgrim Missions can do. Let's not tie our missionaries' hands. It breaks my heart when our pilgrim missionary says, I'm sorry, you know, the money's just not there. It's just not there. They can't send it to me, so I can't go over. So I'm having to leave those nationals there, sitting there, you know, just trying to struggle to see if they can make it on their own because the money's not there to send him over back to Dominica. Folks, that's sad. That is sad. And whose fault is it? It's not the missionary's fault. It's our fault. That's our fault. When we stand before God at judgment day, that's going to fall on us. That's our responsibility. All of you can't go, but oh my, you can pray and you can give. Give till it hurts. Amen. It's good for you every once in a while. Give up a few things. Give up a few things. It'll make you feel so good. Amen. It will make you feel so good. I better be quiet. I better just stop. Pray for our missionary. Don Raines, I have never met. I truly, truly have a high respect, high regard for our missionary.
Amen.
Don Raines. Besides being a Dominican, I mean, he is just as much of a Dominican as an American can be. Just put a little coloring on his face and you wouldn't be able to tell him from a Dominican, really. If you stood, like they said about my father-in-law, if you just turn your back, you wouldn't know the difference. You wouldn't know the difference.
Right.
But he truly has a burden, a heavy burden for the work. And I feel like anything that we can do to make his job easier, to help him in the work with Antigua and Dominica, we must stand behind our missionary. And not only stand behind him, stand behind the one that God is going to call to go set up a formal training program for Dominica. Let's pray. God is going to call someone. There are pilgrims out there that can do this. So many that are capable of doing it. Let's pray that God would, when he calls, those hearts would be willing to step out and go to the most beautiful island in the whole Caribbean to serve God.
Amen.
Lord bless you.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, I appreciated that, didn't you? Stirred my heart. Makes me want to do more for missions. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, I tell you, folks, there's a world that needs Jesus. A lot of times we look at those and say, oh boy, look at them. Amen. Folks, we don't need to curse the darkness, but we need to be the light in the darkness. Amen. We need to be the light in the darkness. Oh God, help me to reach out there and look at them and say, they need Jesus. They need the gospel. Not to look on them and say, ooh, boy, look how they look. Look how they've dressed. Amen. And I tell you what, precious heart, we need to look beyond that mirage that's there in the front and look right down and see what Jesus might see and say, boy, there's one that I can save. There's one I can pick up out of the muck and the mire. There's one that I can use. There's one I can call to the mission field. There's one that I can call to be a pastor. Amen. Or to work. Amen. I say praise God. Hallelujah. We have a job to do. Praise the Lord. Well, at this time, Brother and Sister Randolph are going to come and sing the song, Love Them All the Way to Jesus. And Sister Lyne is going to come and minister to us also. And I appreciate the work that she's doing there in the inner cities, there in Lansing, Michigan. As far as I'm concerned, it's just home missions work. And I know a few months ago we were up there for a missionary service. And my wife and I came away just thrilled and challenged and encouraged. And I thought, Lord, help us to enlarge our vision. Not only, you know, sometimes we can see the needs way across the seas, but we can't see the needs right here at home. But I tell you what, America is a mission field. It is a mission field. Amen. And I just trust that God will help. Amen. The Lord bless them as they come at this time. Amen. And sing, and you pay close attention here the next few minutes.
Wounded eyes, smile. you for that beautiful song, and thank you, Brother Beecher, for the privilege of being here this afternoon. Thankful for the love of God that dwelleth within. Isn't it wonderful to love Him this afternoon? I'm thankful for the Great Commission, and that Great Commission says to go out to every kind, every nation, and touch lives and to teach them God's Word. Teach them that Jesus Christ died for them. What a privilege, what a privilege for that Great Commission to be really working in our lives today. I would like those that really love the Lord to stand up. Amen. Isn't this wonderful? I mean, this is a great tabernacle full of people that love God. You may sit down. Now, you know, if we really believe in the Great Commission, and if we really love God, then we really need to be working for Him. And we need to be working out our back door. I thought as Sister Rundell was talking and pleading for help for those on home missions and for across the sea. You know why things aren't working right? It's because we do not have the vision like we should. We are not busy for God like we should be. You know what? We're just drying up and not replenishing ourselves. And we need to get busy and reach out to the lost and dying world. I love to take little polls, you know. It just makes me feel so good when we take little polls. And so I have just a few little questions here. I want you to stand if God has used you in the last year to win a soul for Him. Good. Wonderful. Good. All right. Everybody, look around. Stand right there. Stay up. Step here. Okay. All right. God has used you to win a soul for Jesus Christ. I want this group to give him a hand. Amen. You may be seated. I want to know what's the rest of you doing? What is the rest of you doing if you have not won anyone to Jesus Christ? Now, most of us, and I sit in the afternoon, the little morning service yesterday, and I heard multitudes of people testify that they're saved and sanctified. And I always felt like, you know, when we're saved and sanctified, we're filled with the Holy Spirit. And when we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we're to be witnesses for Him. And I want to know, you know what? We're supposed to bring forth fruit. We're supposed to multiply, you know, what God has done in our lives. I want to know why the rest of you haven't been winning souls for Jesus. I want to know, where is the fruit? Aren't we supposed to be fruitful? He said, you know, go out and bring forth fruit. Replenish. And you know what? We're not replenishing our churches. Our churches are drying up. You look at the attendance sheets. 14, 13, 23, 33. What is happening? We're not replenishing. Why? It's because, you know what? We're not out there working for Jesus Christ. That is the bottom line. I can make it soft and peddle it soft, but you know what? You're not out there working for Jesus Christ. I want to know this afternoon. How many of you, stand if you will, how many of you have a packed out church on Sunday morning? Stand if you have a packed out church on Sunday morning. Thank you very much. The only ones that stood, not any credit to anybody but the Lansing Church. We are literally so packed out, we need a church so bad, can't even comprehend it. You don't even understand. We are so packed out. 50 and 60 in one Sunday school class. Yes, sir. Thank God for that. So crowded, you can't put chairs in the classrooms. You set them on the floor. So crowded. What is wrong with the rest of you? Why don't you have a packed out church? Why don't you have a packed out church? You need to pack it out. What does the scripture say? One of my favorite scriptures. Oh, I got to get this other one here. Let's see. What's the other question I had? Oh, yes. I love this. How many of you? I loved polls. Because you know why? It should make you feel so guilty. So guilty. How many of you have canvassed around your block in the last year? Last 2 years? Last 3 years? Last 4 years? How many of you have canvassed around your own city block? What's the scripture says? Love thy neighbor as thyself. Most of you don't even know who your neighbors are. How many have taken a tract and a few cookies to your neighbors around that block and invited them to your church? One or two hands I see. Say, have you stand? Stand if you've done that. Amen. Been a few. Thank you, Jesus. A few. Where are the rest of you? Where are the rest of you? You know what you're doing? You're in the comfort zone. You're all comfy. You love to go to church, and you love to worship with your little group. 10, 15, 20, 30. You love to worship, and you don't want anything to disturb that worship. You know, I've had adults leave me because of our ministry, so I know how it is. We want to go to church, and we want to be worshipful, and we want to sit with our lovely little group and testify about the same old rhetoric that you testify for the last 50 years, and don't win one soul for Jesus Christ. Now, that's a pretty sad scenario. You know what? I always felt like a sanctified person ought to be out there knocking on doors. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you need to be out, and you need to be out knocking on doors. You say, Sister Lyon, you're making it kind of rough. I'm following the good book. I had somebody say, don't stereotype me like you, Sister Lyon. Oh, I'm not stereotyping you. I'm telling you what the good book is telling you. The Great Commission is built on, really, the whole New Testament is built on the Great Commission to go out. And you say, I wasn't called. Sorry, that ain't going to work around here. We are all called. We are all called to knock on doors and try to bring the lost in. Amen. And it's a pitiful, pitiful sight. Because we don't. And so we sit in our small little groups, and we talk about being saved and sanctified. Now, I have to just be honest with you. At times, it almost makes me puke. Saved and sanctified, and you haven't won one soul to Jesus Christ in the last year, the last 2 years, maybe the three, four, never? And you say you are filled with the Holy Spirit? Sorry, brother. Something's wrong with the picture. Something is wrong with this picture. You know why? We sat on our little dust, and we do nothing. Come Saturday, how many have a calling route on Saturday? Stand. Stand. Well, I'm talking about a calling route where you're out every Saturday beating on doors. All right, let's give them a hand. They deserve it. Amen. Do you think it's easy to have a calling route on Saturday? You think it's easy to get up and go out about 11 o'clock? And start knocking on doors and going house after house and getting in and out of the car, in and out of the car, 30 or 40 times on Saturday, knocking on doors, out there 5, 6, 7 hours on Saturday. You think it's easy? It is not easy. It's hard work. But you know what? To win a soul, it is hard work. Jesus Christ didn't promise that it would be easy. It is hard work. But that's exactly what you need to be doing to build your church up and get it full. I love this scripture that Jesus gave. You know, he talked about the good servant that was having a dinner. And he said, bring them in. Go out and invite guests, you know. And the guest said, oh, I got to go and take care of I got to get married. And one said, well, I got five oxen I got to take care of. And I bought a piece of land. You know, they were giving excuses. Excuses. Excuses, excuses. I hear them every day. The devil doesn't like it. Isn't that true? We all have excuses. We all say, I can't do it. I don't know how. It's too hot. It's too cold. I got my aches and my pains. We all have excuses, and therefore we do nothing. We do absolutely nothing, and you are guilty of that. Shame on you. You just make up excuses. Well, I don't have the person. Oh, I hear all this rhetoric. It's nothing but garbage. I don't have the personality. Well, you know what? You ask my church people. I got some shy little people here, and they're out knocking on doors on Saturday. You know what? It doesn't take any kind of a personality to go to a door and say, you know what? We got a bus route, or I drive my car right by your neighborhood, and would you care if I could pick up some kids? I'm looking for some kids to pick up and take to Sunday school. Now, how hard is that to do? How hard is that to go up and knock on a door and say, I go right by here, and do you have any children? Do you have any kids that you would love to bring to Sunday school? Now, how hard is that? Well, some people don't like to put them in their car. And then you hear about all the liability. That's a bunch of another garbage. The devil gives you all this rhetoric, you know. It's garbage. Oh, you might get sued, or you might, you know. I had somebody say, I said something about, how many times have you taken cookies down to the neighborhood boys down the street, or the ones that pass your house on bicycles? When I see kids out, I run out my front door with cookies. I had one woman raise her hand and said, but what if a little kid would choke on cookies? I said, okay, you hear of everything. God be it, he'll go to heaven, I hope. You know, A lot of times it's just nothing but the devil. We give excuses. Isn't this what they did to the good servant? They gave excuses. They certainly did. And when the people didn't come, you know what Jesus said? He said, you know what? You go out and you bring the halt and the lame and the blind in. I mean, that's pretty bad. The blind, the lame, the halt, the maimed. And by the way, Brother Beecher said, 10 minutes, Sister Line, and I don't see no clocks. Aren't you glad? And I want to tell you right now, though, you know what? They went out and got the halt and the blind and the blamed. They got them all. They brought them in. And he said, there's still room. And he said, you go out into the highways and the byways, and you compel them to come in. You know what that word compel is? It means urgently invite. Urgently invite. When I have somebody say, well, I don't know if I should live with my kids going out. I say, oh, come on, you know, just if they can wear anything, just bring them. We're free babysitters. We're good at it, man. We'll just help you all we can get those little kids in. I'll do anything. Urgently invite. Don't give up. Yes. Do anything to try to get them come in. Amen. I thought his brother Egan said the other day that when he goes by mailboxes, he prays. Oh, I want to go one more step. I'll put my brakes on. Go up to that house. Knock on that door. Invite them to come to Sunday school and to church. Amen. Absolutely. I mean to tell you what we've done, we've gotten lazy and unconcerned about the lost. Yeah. We've got caught up with our way of living, and we go in with a little hunk of people, and we're happy. And the multitudes are going to hell. Yeah. Everyone, have you ever gone to the mall? Have you ever gone out in the street and literally cried because you think, has anybody asked that little boy? Has anybody asked that lady that's carrying those groceries? Has anybody cared about that man that's standing on the street corner that's begging? Has anybody ever asked him if they know Jesus Christ? What about that Muslim that's all wrapped up in all their garb? Has anybody told him about Jesus? Has anybody witnessed to him? Most likely not. Because you, the Holiness Church, I'm not talking about just the Pilgrim Holiness Church. It's across the Holiness movement. I'm telling you, thousands are missing the mark because they're lazy and unconcerned, and they're not bringing them in. We're not bringing them in, and we're comfortable doing it. Is that the truth? Amen. Am I off the mark? We are comfortable, and we're giving our excuses. And we're not bringing in the lost. We do not see them as dying souls dropping into a never-burning, ever-burning hell. We don't see them like that. We're so taken up with life. We're busy. We're taken up with our own little problems. We are. We're just taking up with our own problems, our own way of living, and we're not reaching out to the lost. And I will tell you, no, they're not out there by multitudes. I wish they were. But when we go out calling, we look for one. You look for one. One. One that'll come. One that'll respond. I tell you what, thousands have went through the church at Lansing. I'm not exaggerating when I say thousands have come and gone. But we look for one that'll pay the price. One that'll get saved. One that'll be tender. One that'll want to pay the price. Because those ones are out there. And they're out there in your community. They're waiting for you. They're waiting for you to knock on their door. They're waiting for you to take them a track and some cookies. They're waiting for you to bring them to Sunday school. And you say, oh, Sister Line, all you bring in is kids. And, you know, I hear this garbage all the time, too. Kids and teenagers, you know, kids and teenagers. Well, every once in a while, we get some parents in. Stand up, Gwen. Stand up, Cherie. Stand up, Brother Bill. Amen, every once in a while. Brother Brown, stand up. Once in a while, you know, you get those kids and you get a parent, and they get saved by God's grace. You look for that one that's really wanting to sell out and go with God. And you know what? Not only that. But children and teens grow up. Did you ever realize that? Did you ever know that? Yes, Patty. Amen. Patty's another one, thank God, from the Lansing Church. Amen. They grow. Yes. And they get saved. Amen. Thank God for that. Amen. I could give you a lot more. I could share with you for hours what God has done. And I'll tell you what, if your church is just not going to ever get stirred and get busy, you come up to Lansing. I'll guarantee you, I'll give you a calling route in 2 weeks. I'll get you out there on that street with me, and I'll show you what it's like and how it's a blessed time. I come home on Saturday sometimes, Saturday evening, Brother Brown, and you know this is the truth. I can't hardly sit down. I'm so stirred up. Why? Because you know what? Bringing them in. It's a thrill. You got new stops, new children, new teenagers that are interested. Sometimes they say, well, they don't want to come. Why, kids don't want to come. Teenagers don't want to come. People don't want to come. That's a lie from hell. That is a lie from hell. You go out there, you invite them, you show interest, you bring them, they'll come. And not only on Sunday morning, but you know, we go a step further. Sunday night, Wednesday night, we haul them in. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. Is there a lot of problems along with it? You better believe it. But is it worth it? Yes! Yes! One soul's worth all the whole world! It's worth it! Praise God for that this afternoon. All right, this afternoon I've got some that have gotten saved in the radius of about a year and a half here at our church. And I just praise God what He's doing, and He can do it for you. And you lazy bums, get out and get busy! Absolutely, get busy for Jesus Christ! Get out there. Get you a little paper. Get you a little paper. Put your address on it. Tell the preacher. By the way, if your pastor isn't doing anything, your church won't do anything. Can I just drop that in your mailbox? If your pastors, you better get busy. Start filling your church out. Start knocking on doors. Go to those ghettos and those slums and those trader courts. Go to the rich people. They don't like you. They won't want you, but you go to them anyway. Absolutely. I had one pastor say, I don't want to go to the slums. I want to get the people that's got money. Well, you can try it, brother, but it don't usually work. Why did Jesus say go to the halt and the blind and the lame? The highways and the byways, those off the street places. But you get out there, you get busy, get your little piece of paper, and you get out there and get your pastor saying, you know what, I'm going to start bringing people in. I'm going to get me a van. It can be a ghetto van. That's what we drive. Ghetto vans, ghetto buses. It don't matter. It works. Amen. Bring them in. Load them up. Anybody want a job for Vacation Bible School? I'll put you to work for Vacation Bible. I'm trying to get some help here. Y'all move up to Lansing, man. We can put you to work. I'll tell you the truth. One night in Vacation Bible School last year, we have two of them. We have one, skip a week, and have another one. We can't accommodate it, so we do routes at a time. One night, we had 283. One night, packed in that church so tight, you can't breathe. You wish you wasn't there. But I will tell you one thing, when you see those kids coming back and they are praying in your junior churches and the tears are streaming down their faces, you say, it's worth it. Amen. You want something to do? You move to Lansing. We'll put you up till you get a house. We'll put you up till you get a job. Amen to that, boy. We need help. Praise God. You all move up there. I'll put you to work. Then you won't be lazy bums anymore. Amen. Thank God for that. All right. I'm taking too much time. Brother Beecher's on antsy back here. But you know what? God has blessed us so much. And I just have to introduce these real quick. But this first little girl, her name is Val. And one Saturday I was out calling, and I ran into a commune of people from Thailand. And I walked up the steps, and there were some little kids out there, a little set of twins. And I went over to the little twins. I said, honey, would you like to come to Sunday school and learn about Jesus? And the little girl said, who's Jesus? USA. Who's Jesus? I said, would you like to come? I'll talk to your mommy. We'll bring you to Sunday school. I brought those little girls from Thailand, and they brought a cousin, and that cousin's name is Paul, and she's given her heart to Jesus Christ. Amen. I want her to testify.
I've been going to the church for almost 3 years now, and Jesus saved me not too long ago, and He's been helping me to fight temptation, and He's been speaking to my heart. And I've been reading His word, and He's been helping me to memorize His word. And He had called me to be a missionary, and after high school, I'm going to go to a Bible college and to where the mission field and to be faithful to Him, and I love Him.
Hey.
Today.
Hey. One Sunday morning a while back, Val, she seeks God a lot. And one Sunday morning, she grabbed a hold of my skirt and she said, Sister Line, Jesus really did save me. And I was just starting to cry, and I hugged her. I started to walk away, and she grabbed me and she said, and He called me to the missionary field. I said, praise God. I had a shouting spell that Sunday. Praise God for what He's done. Amen. Well, the next fella, we were out Vacation Bible School calling. I knocked on a door. And a man stuck his head out, and I could tell he'd been drinking quite a bit. I said, we're doing some Vacation Bible School calling. We're having Vacation Bible School. You got any kids to send? He said, yeah, I do. So I signed him up. And I started to walk away, and when I did, he stuck his head out again, and he said, "I got a 13-year-old boy that needs to be in church. I'll send him to." And I said, "We'll take him." That 13-year-old boy is Brian Young. Brian, come.
It seems so long ago since Sister Lynn actually came and knocked on the door, and a white lady in that part of town is either stupid or crazy.
Thank you. Both.
I think she's both. it seems so long ago. I had no idea. I had no idea that I would go through the things that I went through. But I started going to church during vacation Bible school because my dad needed a babysitter, like most parents do. And so I went. And then after I went, she came back and said, "Well, would you like to keep going to Sunday school, you know, after vacation Bible school?" I said, I don't know. And she was like, "Well, you know, we give out candy." "Yeah, I'll go. I'll go for candy." So I was 13, so I wanted candy, so I went. And after that, I went because of girls. And then after that, the Lord started speaking to my heart. And I didn't go for girls or candy anymore. I went because I got something there that I didn't get. A missionary field, my definition of a missionary field is where people outreach to the lost and give to them what they don't have. It can be in Guatemala, Honduras. It can be right at home. You can give people what they don't have. This could be a long story, but I don't want to take up time. But they gave to me what I didn't have. There were situations, and I got kicked out of the house, and I mean, tons of things happened, and I went through a lot of maturing. While I lived with them, I did, and the Lord showed me a lot of stuff. But I'm so thankful for what He's done. The example that they gave me, even just as a little ghetto kid, was unbelievable. I never seen I did see them disagree, but I never seen mom and pops argue. I never seen them argue. My parents would leave the room with black eyes and cursing and all kinds of stuff, and I didn't see that from them, and I wondered about that. It seemed a little weird to me, but that's what holiness is, you know? And I stayed with them for a year. I stayed with them for a year, and I tried to be a Christian. I tried so hard, but I didn't. I wasn't true to God, and they asked me all the time. I remember nights, endless nights, where we sat up, me and mom, we sat up and talked and cried, and I wanted the Lord so bad, but I was just out on a limb. I didn't know what to do. I was so gone, and I ended up moving back home even, and it was only by the Lord's grace that I am where I am today, because I came back to camp, and I'm sure the Hartkopf family knows a little bit about it, but I sat over there in that area. And me and David Hartkopf were riding. And the only reason I came to camp last year was to play basketball. I didn't have any other reason to come. I didn't know why to come. I could care less about camp. Camp was so stupid. It was just boring to me. I'd go play basketball, hit and miss a few services, whatever. And David asked me. I can't remember. Can I get some tissue? I can't remember exactly what he said, but I let him know, "David, I don't know. I remember when the Lord used to talk to my heart. And that message Brother Agin gave last night would have hit home. Would have hit home." He said that you don't want to wait until the Lord doesn't talk to you. And that's what I was afraid I had done. I was afraid I had waited too long. I had played around with salvation too long, and that the door was closed. I was so much in fear. I didn't know what to do. And I told David, "I don't know what to do. I mean, it's so hard to be a Christian where I'm living at. There are people drinking and fighting at my house and across the street every day on a regular basis. I mean, it's almost impossible to be a Christian." And we continue to write back and forth. And so sometimes parents don't condemn your children for writing back and forth over there too much. But we were writing back and forth, and he said, "Well, you know, do you want to try to go to the altar and pray about it?" And I said,
Yeah, I guess. And I came up here, and the Lord saved me. And I'm so thankful for that. And it all began with a family, a church family that cared for me and took me in. I mean, even when they knew I was bad and they knew that I had done the wrong things or something, they still loved me. And they tried so hard to keep me in, and they did. They did a good job. This is a family that I wish I could have been a part of instead of my family. I mean, I really love the Lions. And last year at camp, someone offered me a job and told me that it'd be good if I went to Bible college. You know, I'd have a job, and it was one of the Lions. And I decided to take that job and go to Bible college and seek God's will for my life. And here I am today, still in Bible college and wanting to do God's will for my life. And it was all because of a family that knocked on the door and asked if I'd go to vacation Bible school.
Thank you, Brian. All right, the next gal, her name's Amanda. And we canvass our neighborhood, you know, a lot. I'm out there, man. I see somebody moving in or with a U-Haul. I'm out there knocking on their door. And I saw the U-Haul move into this empty house. And I went down the next day. You don't wait, man. You don't wait till they get settled in. That's a lot of garbage, you know. You just get there right now and invite them to Sunday school. So I got 5 little kids out of that house. And they came about, 5 or 6 months. And one day I heard a knock on my door. And they had a teenage gal. She was about 13, 14. And that was Amanda. And they said, "Is it all right we bring our big cousin?" And Amanda's been coming for about 9 years to our church now. But God has marvelously helped Amanda.
I feel like I should shrink down behind this thing. I'm so nervous, but with God's will, I'll be able to give you a good testimony. Well, like Sister Lyon said, I've been going to the church for 9 years. I've been doing my own thing for most of those 9 years. I've done everything. I've tried the drugs. I've tried the alcohol. I've tried the boys. I've tried everything, and nothing has satisfied that hole in my heart as much as Jesus has. A couple months ago, my grandma had passed away in December, and I was really slipping away. I didn't even go to church anymore. I didn't feel like it. I was like, I got better stuff to do on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. I could work. I could hang out with friends, or I could go to the bar. Most of the time, I did go to the bar on Sundays. I lived with a couple guys, and the last one I lived with, I broke down. I started crying all the time. I was going into really bad depression. I cried every day. I said, "You guys," I said, "I don't know where my life is going." I said, "I can't even hardly pay my rent bill here." I said, "I'm going to be working at Famous Taco for the rest of my life. And if you know me, you know I hate my job. It doesn't even pay enough to work there, but I'm there." And I decided that it was time to go back to church, and that's when Brother Smart was coming to our church for a revival, and Brother Smart preached and preached and preached, and sometime during his preaching, I went to the altar, and I sought God. I don't believe he saved me that week during the service, but I didn't miss a single service of the preaching, and a little while after that, God saved me and spoke to my heart and said that I need to go to UBC and be a teacher. I believe that I've really been given the gift to work with children, and my will is to do what God wants me to do, which I believe is to reach to those children and teach them about Jesus.
Got her enrolled in UBC, praise God. I love it because, you know, it helps so wonderful. And I tell you what, I praise God for my boys that are down here in this area. Because, you know, when off-the-street kids get saved, you can ask Brother Brown or Cherie or Gwen or any of them that's got saved. They carry a lot of baggage with them from the past. And they have a lot of nurturing they need. So I set them down here, and Brian, Darren pick them up and help them. Jobs in church, and used to have Craig, but he's going to evangelistic work now. But anyway, it just helps to get them down here for they can be nurtured, and I praise God for that. But just pray for Brian and Amanda that God will just help them at UBC, that they'll find the will of God. All right, the next fella is Rick Salisbury, And Patty's been saved for a long time. Her brother Jimmy's been saved. And they came when the Rainses came and got saved. And every once in a while, we'd see Rick. He'd pop in, you know. But God brought him in. I can truly say God brought him in, and God has changed his life. And I want him to testify. I told him a couple minutes, because he's a long talker too, you know. You don't be here all day. But I tell you what, he's been a miracle for the church, because we run buses. We got three buses running on Sunday now, and we pack them in. And Rick, he works hard to keeping those buses up. He has saved us thousands of dollars working on those buses, and I say thank God for that. I praise God for that. All right, Brother Rick, I want you to come and give your testimony.
I was just quietly reminded 2 minutes. It wasn't too long ago, I asked the Lord to forgive me, because I was rotten. I was rotten to the core. And I stand you, nervous, shaking wreck, because I know that. It's something he pointed out to me, and I asked, I was sorry, and he forgave me. And now I'm sitting in front of a bunch of people that are crying. Half of you have been shot dead by Sister Line. But I love that lady dearly. She lured me in with food one day. As you can tell, I don't need any more food either, but she knew where to get me. She did a good job. I started listening to her, and that's all I had to do. All I had to do was stop and listen. And I started listening to other people. Brother Brown, Brother Cheat, my little sister Patty, my brother John. All I had to do was listen. And the Lord came to my heart. He said, man, you're rotten. He said, you're just plain rotten. And you're a sinner, and I love you. And I did have a message, probably way too long. And like Sister Lyon said, there's no clock, so you guys blew it. But I do love the Lord, and that's his message for us this afternoon. He loves us dearly, and we know that. I came in this morning intentionally for prayer service. I didn't know what to expect. I expected a couple hundred people hanging around praying. It was quiet, and there wasn't a couple hundred people in here praying. But the people that were, they were praying. And the solace was great, because I came in here and I started praying, and I've grown accustomed to walking around when I pray, but there was quite a few people walking around, so they're all older than I was, so I didn't want to run into anybody. So I just knelt down and prayed for a while, and the Lord came to me, and I asked my questions now, and I know to take a moment to listen. I know that. That's a very important lesson for us to remember, because in our world today, everything is so hectic. We run, we go, we go, we go. We chase, we chase, we chase. The dollar, things, people, just absolutely nothing that's important. But when I stop to listen, the Lord comes to me and he answers my questions. And that's precious to me, because he saved me and he loves me. Like I said, I'm a shaking, nervous wreck. The crowd's too big. When I've got my own little crowd, I can rant and rave for hours. And I'm trying not to cry. You guys are not being a lot of help over here. You know that? But I do love the Lord.
Amen.
And I love my church family dearly. They're supportive. They're great cooks. And I'm learning a lot of things.
Amen.
Last Friday, I was in service with Brother Agin, opened up our church camp. And he said something that really, really was very important for all of us, old, young. It's really scary to think of where our church is going when I looked at it this week. I fasted, I prayed, and I prayed some more. We've got a big, huge gap. A big, huge gap between the older saints and wherever it's supposed to be going. I'm 37 years old, And if we don't start bringing them in, and if we don't start getting some of these people saved, if we don't start getting a support group going to where we end up with some old saints, our pews are going to get lighter.
That's right.
I mean, praise the Lord for Brother Walton. I know his name. Brother Gray. Mr. Raines. Brother Raines. Like I said, Brother Christie. They're not going to be here forever. We love them dearly. So if the Lord gives you a call, and even if you're not very good at it, or if you're scared to death, you better get behind the podium, and you better start praying, praying, praying. Because that's the only way we're going to get there. The older gentlemen, a few older ladies this morning, they were in here praying. I don't know what they were saying. I was busy praying, but they were in here. And all they were doing was praying. That's where our answers lie, in our missions.
That's right.
In our missions. I'm up here during a mission service, out of all things, and I live 380 miles north of here. But our missions are important. I don't make it to knock out on doors, but I do fix the buses. I'm beginning to call them oxen. Just because I would like to shoot them on Sunday sometimes. But I dearly love the Lord, and we do have to remember to pray. And I'm sure I'm over my 2 minutes, but I knew I would be. So did a lot of other people. But I love the Lord. And thank my church family for bringing me in.
Amen.
Amen.
Leaving all behind them.
precious hearts, we've heard the story today. Can we just sit idly by and say they're on their way to eternity? We have a job to do. I have a job to do. I'd like for Brother and Sister Randolph to sing maybe that chorus again. And if you're really serious about saying, Lord, would you help me to be what